Hello, friends, fans, and followers. Matt with Tales on Trails Deer Tracking Podcast. Back with another spin-off podcast from the Trackers Forum, this time joined by Jeremiah Gracie. Last time we were joined by Carrie Hummel and Megan Schmidt out of Oklahoma. Today we are joined with Jeremiah Gracie out of Vermont. Jeremiah, how are you, sir?
Pretty good. Yourself?
I'm great, man. Thank you. Thanks for coming on, buddy.
Yeah, happy to do it.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun, man. You know, the Trackers Forums were a lot of fun, and, you know, I know you weren't able to join part two, but it sure was fun having you on parts one and three.
And yeah, enjoy it.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. So, hey, I got to ask you, but I mean to ask everybody, how about you like that new intro video? It's not new anymore.
It's not new? That's the same one. I do like it.
I like it.
It's up pretty good.
That's a cool song, man. I love that song, a little pep. But anyway, yeah, that was fun. So Jeremiah, man, yeah, again, thanks for coming on. And, you know, a number of things that we want to talk about. You know, folks, as I said, Jeremiah tracks out of Vermont. By the way, I should back up and say Jeremiah's tracking service is Gracie Tracking Service out of Vermont. Please go to Jeremiah's Facebook page. Do you have a tracking page specific, Jeremiah? Is it just your personal page?
No, I got personal one, then one for Gracie Tracking Service.
Okay, yeah, go to search Gracie Tracking Service on Facebook and follow Jeremiah there. And if you audio people, if you'd like to see the video here, the live stream, if you will, go to Tales on Trails Deer Tracking on Facebook or YouTube, and you'll see the live stream there if you want the video version. So again, a lot of fun, man. Number of things we can chat through, chat about rather. And as fellow trackers, we're never at a loss of something to talk about, but we're constantly at a loss to stay on topic and try to fit it in a reasonable amount of time that people will endure listening to or watching on a live stream or an audio podcast. So, because it's just so fun for us. So, Jeremiah, let's start. Tell us about yourself. What got you into tracking? Jeremiah's a trapper too. So, you know, what got you into tracking? And just give us a little background, buddy.
Yeah. Well, honestly, I got into tracking as a happenstance. Backing up a little bit, I've trapped for years and I love trapping. And I started my brother actually one year. He came home from a trip and he brought with him this little puppy. It was a little Elkhound. Never heard about the breed, never knew nothing about it, nothing like that. But my brother left her with us. He got her right in November and he's a big time deer hunter. He goes all over the place. And so he bought a puppy spontaneously and then left her with us. And, you know, we get her from time to time and I started doing stuff with her.
Yeah.
And one of the things I started doing was bringing her with me on the trap line. And that's when I started realizing just how cool this dog breed was. And one of the things that really struck me was just their memory. Their memory is incredible. The first year I took, so my brother's dog's name's Rosa. I still get her quite a bit. So the first year I took Rosa trapping with me, you know, she showed huge interest in everything having to do with beaver trapping and trapping otter and trapping muskrats. And also, she loved it. She loved being outside with me. And then, you know, our season here in Vermont is October through March. So then the summer went by. And that next fall, I started going out to set my traps, and I happened to have Rosa with me again because my brother is out deer hunting. Yeah. And some of the spots I frequent for trapping, you know, I go every single year. And I remember like going in October to set traps for the first time, and Rosa would just bust out of the truck and she'd run ahead of me and she'd go back to where I had traps the previous year. And she would be like looking down the water, looking at all the exact spots. And it really impressed me, like her memory,
Wow. How
she like associated those positive experiences of catching animals. And she just, you can see her eyes light up. Like she loved it. She loves anything to do with hunting. She loves anything to do with trapping. Like she's all about it. And a couple of years went by and I decided to get a elk hound of my own. And I ended up getting my dog Trapper. And he's, I pretty much same thing. I got him in November, and I didn't really hunt that much that year. What I did hunt, I just shoved him in my coat and took him with me because he's just an itty-bitty little puppy. Mm-hmm. And then once deer season was over, we just hit the trap line. I work seasonally in the winter as a sugar maker, so I'm always out in the woods anyway, and trapper just came with me for those first 6 months every single day. And by the end of that 6 months in the spring, I was looking for more things to do with him. I knew that I'd wanted, like, trapping's only a part of the year, so I wanted something more to do with him. And so I started looking around, and I got on the Vermont Fish and Wildlife website, and first thing I found is that I could get a bear dog permit for him. So I got a bear dog permit, and then I saw listed underneath of it, leash tracking dog permit. And then I looked at the application process, and I called up the guy who runs the program here, and his name's Tim Nichols. And he, I remember the very first conversation I had with him, it was right in August. So it was at the end of his training season. And I got on the phone with him and said, you know, I'm interested in training my dog to do something more, just have another activity to do with him. Like, what can you tell me? He's like, well, what kind of dog do you have? And I said, I have a Norwegian Elkhound. And he's like, holy shit, I got to pull over. And he was like, all right, tell me everything. And I was like, well, I got this little dog. He's been doing good. We trapped and all that stuff. And I'd like to try and, you know, see if he can find some animals, if that's, you know, just something else we could do.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, you know, I've heard all about these dogs. I've never seen one, but I've heard about them. He says, like, one of the guys that he used to track with years ago said that Elkhounds they could track anything anywhere, and he said he wanted to try it out. So he invited me down. He runs a course for tracking, that's a certification course for the state, and he lays all these lines everywhere, and he laid out a little puppy line, because at that point Trapper is only 8 months old, so he was still pretty young, and he'd never practiced with him, never did nothing with it. I had just barely read John Jenny's book, and because Tim had told me to pick it up and give it a breeze through. And so I went down to the class, and Tim had laid out a puppy line, which is just a very simple, like, he had this big field. He just laid it, like, fall on the edge for, you know, two-thirds of the field and left a chunk of hide. Pretty simple stuff with a little bit of mud. And so we set Trapper on it. He got about 5 feet on that bloodline, and then he just picked his head up, sniffed at the air, and he cut straight across the field and went right to the deer hide. He said, screw the track, we're going to go that way.
He air-scented it, huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He air-scented it right off the top. And Tim's like, holy crap, you got a winder. And he was all excited. And then so he's like, well, I got a couple other trails. And he's like, so we put him on a – he has a, you know, various levels from easy to difficult type deal.
Yeah.
And so he gave us, like, a middle-sized track to do, which was, you know, had some hills in it, had, you know, going into the woods, coming back out into a field, going back into the woods, dipping down, all that kind of stuff. And Trapper did it without a hitch. He just went right off. There's one point where he actually veered off of the trail, but it was because about 80 yards later, there was an actual coyote kill. Like, there was a dead deer in the woods. And so he went off of the actual training trail and found a deer for the very first time. It was just a, you know, I mean, there wasn't much left to it. The coyotes had done a pretty good job on it. But then after we got him back on the actual trail, he finished that. And I was talking with him, and there was someone else who was also taking the class, and their dog had been through the class all summer long, and they were on the hardest trail that Tim had set for the night, and their dog couldn't find it. And so he had to go through that anyway to go get the hide so he could pick it up, so that he wasn't, like, you know, littering in the place. And he's like, well, since we're walking, you mind if we just try it, just see what he does? And Trapper blew right through that last one. Like, he went over a beaver dam, crossed a brook, like, went up the brook a couple yards, came out on the same side he went in on, and just essentially blew me away, blew Tim away, and I was excited about it. We took two of those classes, and then I took my test to get certified, and then we just started doing it. It was a month later, Trapper found his first deer in a live situation. It was very easy.
So, and he was 8 months old at the time you're running, you're exposing him to simulated lines.
Yeah, that was the very first time. And then he found his first deer. It was a couple days after turning one.
Wow. So that line that the other dog wasn't able to find, that Trapper blew through, would would you equate that to like a UBT2 line or harder, or do you know for sure?
Honestly, I don't know. I haven't looked at the UBT scorings and how they do that stuff, because it's mostly what I found is Trapper doesn't track like a lot of traditional hounds. Like he doesn't, there's very little nose to the ground. It's all like, he's primarily a air center. That's his number one go-to game. And then once he's, if he can't do it with the air setting, he turns to his eyes. He'll actually try and look for it for a while. And then he, if he doesn't do that, then he'll turn down to the nose and be like, oh, damn it, I got to go slow and actually like pick it up off
the ground. So then he starts going, what we'll say step, you know, for sake of conversation, step for step, which isn't necessarily really what they're doing. But wow, so that, I don't know. That all this just fascinates me. So for the people who don't know, describe what an elk hound is. Their physical, you know, their size, what they look like. You know, what are they? You know, every dog was kind of bred for some type of purpose. You know, any type of working breed, anyway. What is the Norwegian Elkhound's folklore for a purpose? Do you know?
Oh yeah. No, so as far as their appearance, they look like a husky, but more compact, a little bit smaller. They're a little bit shorter in the legs, and their tails aren't straight. They curl right up on the back, like, and they sit kind of like, it looks like a little cinnamon bun sitting right on the top of their back. What's pretty cool about them is they're actually one of the oldest genetically unchanged dog breeds that there are. They have so they're traditionally from Norway. There's several types within their little group, because there's the Norwegian Elkhound, there's the Norwegian Black Elkhound, there's a Swedish Elkhound, and then there's the Karelian Bear Dog, which are all very similar in their function and their general look, except for some slight color variations and size variations. But their elkhounds were bred primarily for hunting moose. In Norwegian, the word for moose is elg, E-L-G. And their word for dog is hund, H-U-N-D. So elkhound is actually a really bad translation, because they have nothing to do with elk as we think about it. And they're not hound dogs. They're spitzes. So they have prick ears that stand up off the top of their head, really curly tails, and then long, thick northern coats. So they're, you know, primarily used for moose hunting. They've been used for bear hunting pretty considerably. And they're actually, they're very rare here in America, and they're less popular. But in, if you go over to Norway or Sweden or Finland, they're everywhere. And they're one of the primary tracking dogs that they have over there. They have whole certifications like we do, but it would be like going to a huge meet with like 400 or 500 dogs, and 85% of those are going to be elk hounds. That's what they're used for over there now, more than anything, other than hunting moose. That's really their big game.
So when they're hunting moose, are they you know, doing it just to, do you know how that works over there? Are they using it just to locate the moose?
They have two styles. They have what they call Leashhund and Bandenhund. So on leash or off leash. They always run on one, maybe two dogs at a time, but it's primarily one. They're trained more to work in tandem with hunters and just be a singular dog. The loose hounds, they're trained to go out, you know, they sniff out ahead of them. And then they find the moose, and then it's like a baying, like they ground bay. They bark and circle and keep the moose in a particular area. That way they can do it. And then their Bandenhunds or leash hounds, similar, except for it's more of, the best way I can describe it, it's kind of like having a pointing dog on a leash. So they, you know, track and they just stay right there in front of them. And then when they have a way, they know what they're looking for as far as the scent goes, and then they lead you to the animal from downwind. So they'll lock on a scent, and then they'll just work against the wind until they see the animal. Then they stop, and then they just point, which is what he does when we bear hunt. Like, that's, it's very similar. So
you actually bear hunt with Trapper?
Oh, yes. Yep, certainly do. I've only shot one bear off of him, because it's one of those things where I don't have the most time to do. It's a pretty, I mean, it's a long season here in Vermont. We can do it from September until the middle of November. But the biggest problem is generally in September, it's too damn hot for him. He hates the heat. That's his one real downside.
Really mammoth.
He'll track in hot weather, but he doesn't like the hunt in it. If he doesn't have blood right there, it doesn't, like, he'd rather just not.
But really?
It's primarily in middle to late October for bears. That's when we go. That's when we finally start getting the cold enough weather where he likes to do it. And we've been on 7 bears since he was a year old, and I've only chosen to shoot one of those. But for various reasons, either, we came up to a bear that was too small, or it was a sow with cubs, or,
Sure.
I'm looking for meat bears, honestly. So I'm really looking for that 135 to 200 pound range for myself. And if it doesn't fit that criteria, we let them walk.
How common is that size bear in Vermont?
Oh, very. We have a very healthy population here.
So that's just kind of a staple.
Oh yeah. If we wanted to, we could get on 2-3 bear a day if we really wanted to put the hours in and boots on the ground. They're all, especially where I live. I'm right in the center of the state up in the Green Mountains. I live on my family's farm, and we're surrounded by national forest. So out my backyard, we got bear crossing on the yard all the time. It's not a big deal to run into them all over the place.
Yeah. Jeez. And here I am in southern Michigan, totally fascinated by all of that. And you're like, what are you talking about? They're almost a nuisance species, probably.
But between getting into the gardens, getting into the bees, just getting into the chickens, they are everywhere. And they're getting less and less afraid, too, with Vermont as it's developing. Oh. That's a whole other issue, though.
Yeah. So you hunt bear, or have hunted bear with Trapper. Do you also track bear
for other hunters?
So how does he distinguish between the two? Are you on lead when you're hunting too? Are you off lead hunting, on lead tracking? How does he distinguish between the job you're asking him to do?
I think the biggest part is if we're tracking, it's in the truck driving someplace, and then we meet somebody. He knows, okay. Like when we're going down the road, then we pull off a smaller road, and then he sees a pickup parked with someone standing there. He knows what we're doing.
Yeah. But
whenever we go hunting, it's always we just walk out the back door and go. Or like this year, we did a little bit of it when I was up north in the Northeast Kingdom scouting for my moose permit. And I took him with me to help me scout. And that was just a whole different situation. Like he knows very differently. And it's kind of weird to say, but I also think he knows what my guns mean. Like he knows different guns. I pick up 22. He knows we're going after squirrels. If I pick up my my bear rifle, he knows that's what we're doing. But if I pull out my chest rig with my handgun, he knows we're going tracking.
I totally believe that. I know Baru, this hound dog, when I pull down a dirt road or a dirt driveway or something, she starts going bananas, whining and fussing and carrying on. I mean, we don't do anything but track and be a pass. We don't, obviously with bloodhound, we don't hunt, and there's, we don't have bears in southern Michigan anyway. But that's just bad. So how much does a Trapper weigh? What do you think?
He's big for the breed. He fluctuates right now anywhere from 70 to 80 pounds. But we've also discovered he's got a thyroid issue. So we just got him on medication for that a couple months ago, and he's starting to lose weight, which is good. Okay. But he's definitely big. And I think a lot of that is just because of how much I run him, moving around, and his diet. From a little puppy, the biggest thing, he ate beaver, and more beaver. And then also I kept him on raw milk for a while because we had a milk cow. And that was what he was raised on. And then now we get, I try to get every roadkill deer I can, especially from ones I find. People that know me know that, if they see a roadkill deer, just call me and I'll go get it. Or like I've got to have a great relationship with all the game wardens around here. Okay. And, I try and source that kind of stuff, whether it's roadkill bear, roadkill deer, or beaver. That's what I try and put to them the most. But
and
that so helps
you be bigger. You're feeding him raw.
Primarily. Partially. So partially. He eats probably about 65% raw, and then the rest of it, he eats a really high-grade fish-based kibble.
Fish-based. So what do you do with when you go, how do you process the deer or the bear to feed to trapper? Are you is it grinding it or what do you do? How do you do feeding?
So if it's, if say we got a roadkill deer, I chunk it up into blocks, like 2 or 3 pound blocks type deal, and I freeze it. And then, so some things like the organs, like all of the organs, I freeze them up, slice them thin, and dehydrate them for him. So he has dehydrated options too. That helps me carry stuff when we're in the woods a little bit easier. But other than that, he eats, he'll get a little, 3/4 cup of kibble, and then he'll get a cup of just chunked up raw meat. That's, it could be a variety of any of those types of animals that I get. And then he gets a little bit of the dehydrated organs on top of it all. And that's pretty much his daily meal.
He probably thinks he eat like a king, man.
Well, I tell you what, it's more work, but it's a lot cheaper.
It's
a lot cheaper doing it, especially with the trapping. Because, if I can get 25, 30 beavers in a year, and they're, say your average beaver is 40 to 50 pounds, I can take 8 to 15 pounds of meat, just boneless meat off of a beaver. And that really adds up. It takes them about a week to generally eat an average size beaver. So really? It really, when I can get 25 beavers, that's, that's half the year right there. Like, that's a pretty decent amount of meat.
And it is, like you said, it's a lot of work and effort, but it, nearly $50 a bag I'm paying for my dogs. Yeah. That's a nice saving. That dog food adds up fast, man. I mean, I don't mind it. I mean, I wish I didn't have to pay it, but it's for the dog. So I don't complain about it, but wow. And healthy and lean.
It's the best diet you can get them on. Like, it really, it's what coyotes eat. It's what wolves eat. Everything eats beaver. Sure, yeah. That's what I learned when I started trapping. Is the guy who taught me how to trap beaver. He's like, the big thing you need to understand is everything eats beaver. And I was like, well, I was skinning them, so why not feed them to the dog?
Yeah, because what were you doing with them before you feed them to the dog? I mean, obviously you'd keep the hide or sell the hide. Or what would you do with the rest of them?
Other than that, I would use them for before I had dogs. I mean, I used to feed it. My brother's dog Rosa, I would save it for whenever she was home. But prior to having Rosa, I would use them, put them out as bait. I would use my beavers as like fisher bait or coyote bait or something like that. Okay. Other than that, that was really the only use I had for them. I mean, I've eaten quite a few of them myself. The littler ones are actually really good, as long as you don't have some big, rangy old boar of a beaver. Yeah. Beaver meat's actually quite good. I mean, I've eaten the hams off them and the back straps there. I mean, it's just like beef, they're like little grazers, because all they eat is tree cambrium. So it's a nice, healthy, red, dark red meat. There's nothing wrong. It's got a great taste to it.
Yeah. I know a lot of folks in the sporting dog world feed raw. I don't. I've flirted with the idea, but never researched it or anything. But I know it's not uncommon for people to feed raw. But I'm just kind of taken by the fact, you know, beavers and bear. I don't know why. That's just, I imagine they'd love it. That's awesome, man. Well, cool. The heck else was I going to ask about Trapper? How old is Trapper?
He's 4 and a half now. No, he'll be, sorry, his birthday's at the end of September, so he'll be 5 when we get into this next season.
Man, he'll be right in his prime. So what's the average lifespan, do you know, of an Elkhound?
15 to 17.
That long?
Yeah, they're a pretty long lived breed. They're smaller, they're more compact. But like I said, they're, it's like a Malamute but half the size. Like, they're just nice little mid sized dog. I mean, I got a little female too, and she's 42 pounds, and she's not going to get any bigger than that.
Okay, I'll be darned. That's fascinating to me, man. I don't know why. I just love that. So you got this little fluff nugget.
Yep.
So let me back up. What's the temperament like of an elk hound? Are they lovey? Are they antisocial? Are they independent? How are they?
So the way I've heard them described by a lot of people, and it seemed to be true, is their personality mirrors. Whatever you want, they want. The biggest thing is they bond to one person. Like they'll love a whole family group. They love kids, but they'll really bond strong to one person in the family. And then they just want to be with that person. I mean, Trapper's, he's a complete house dog. He's in here, like he sleeps on the bed, next to the bed, in front of the door. Yeah. Like he's a great dog. Like kids love him. He loves kids. He loves babies particularly. He loves watching you. If there's a baby, he'll sit there and watch it for hours. Loves it. He's actually super gentle. Like he loves I raised quite a few animals, so he has a lot of experience with like baby ducks, baby chickens.
Oh yeah.
Loves getting in with the piglets. He loves watching calves. Like he's about as timid a little dog as can be until you got a gun in your hands. And then there's a switch. And he's all serious. Like his ears stand up more, his eyes narrow, and he's like, what are we doing? Let's do it.
He's
all business at that point. Like it's amazing. It's really, it's just a switch. Like it's like having a completely different dog.
Yeah.
I'd say the one of the things that stood out, like to explain that, is this year I had a bit of a, it just impressed me about him. Normally, like I said, he has trouble with the heat, and I've tried to track with him a couple times when it's above 80 degrees, and usually it doesn't go too well. Like he just ends up wanting to find water. But this year, the very first track we had, where we got a call for, was a bear call. It was like the third or fourth day of the season, so it was September 3rd or 4th, and it was like 92 degrees out. It was horrible. It was so freaking hot up here. And this guy called me, asked me if I could track a bear for him. I was like, I don't know. I gave him a couple other numbers to call first. I was like, my dog just really doesn't like the heat. I was like, so here's a couple other guys. Call them. If you can't get it, call me back. Let me know what's going on. Because he was only like 15 miles away from my house. So it was actually really close.
Yeah.
But it was 94 degrees out. Like he was inside with the AC on and he was panting. The short story is the guy couldn't get anybody else to come, call me back. Begged me to try it. I was like, I'll give it a shot, especially because he said it was in a corn piece. He shot it in a corn piece right next to a cedar swamp. He says there was, you know, knee deep water everywhere where the bear hit it out. So I was like, well, you know, maybe we'll stay cool. And I said, I can't guarantee nothing. We'll come and try it. And I drove, we drove out to go meet this guy, and Trapper was just dying in the truck. Like we had the AC blasting. He was just panting. His tongue was rolling out. I was like, I don't know how good this is going to be. So I stopped and talked to the guy. I was like, we can try it. We can see what he does, but I'm not feeling very comfortable with this.
Right.
But so we took him for a little walk, and we went along the edge of the corn piece to where he shot the bear. And Trapper got within 10 feet of the hit site. And he just, that switch turned. His ears went up, his tongue went in his mouth, and he stopped panting, and he didn't give a shit. He ran over to the hit site, put his nose down, sniffed it, and then he looked up like in the direction of where the bear had gone, and he just put his nose up into the air, and then he ran. He ran 3/4 of a mile and did it in 9 minutes, and we were standing over that bear. It was one of the more impressive things I've ever seen him do, just because he overcame
his
discomfort. Like he overcame like everything that beforehand, as soon as he smelled that blood for the first time that year, he was all about it.
Wow.
It was pretty cool. And it's just cool seeing that switch in a dog like that, where it can be
absolutely
not only personality changing, but also like you see him desiring to do it. Like you see him like,
I mean, his drive switch went on high.
Because I do have to say, like, for that drive, too, like, it was the first call of the year. You know, we hadn't done it in 4 or 5 months, and he just wasn't, like, he wasn't thinking of it in his head. You know, we just kind of got in the truck, we're going for it. And then he saw someone in the truck, and he got a little excited, and then we started walking, and he got his leash clipped on him, and then he smelled that blood. And once that blood hit his nose, it was a whole different thing.
Wow. So how do hunters react when you show up and... You know, we always talk about it when people get out of the truck with their little Dachshund or something. that's at least, it seems to me, is becoming more and more understood and accepted. But how do people respond when you get out of the truck with a fluff ball like crapper?
I don't think many people expect it, that's for sure.
Yeah.
I think they honestly, at this point, especially up here in Vermont, because of John Denny, most people expect you to show up with a dachshund. But when Trapper gets out of the truck, they're always like, oh, huh, well, I guess I didn't think to bring a wolf, but that's a good idea. that kind of stuff. I mean, as soon as people meet Trapper, it doesn't matter if we're tracking or anything else, everybody loves him. He's a complete personable little man. Like, he'll run right up to people, and he's so long as everyone around him is happy, he's happy. He's all about it. And I mean, I don't think I've ever really run to someone who's met him and not liked him instantly. He's got a personality to him. Like, everybody loves him. And he's as amenable as a dog as possible. You know, he's happy looking around, like, and he's not like running off, taking, like, you know, I let him out of the truck and he's just right there, like no leash, nothing like that. He knows what he's doing, and he's a very well behaved, well controlled dog.
Well mannered. Well, that's cool. That's cool. So you do get the occasional, what the heck?
Oh yeah, for sure.
I can imagine that's
but then cool. Once they see him start working, though, everybody loves him. And generally, like, I've had a lot of repeat customers that just, they call for Trapper. Like, they just, it's just the way it is.
Yep. Yeah, that's super cool, man. And especially if he finds the deer for him or the bear or whatever. I mean, now he's their hero forever, you know?
Oh, absolutely. Especially when he does it in, like, because like I said, he's much more of a winder. So he's not always, like, sometimes he just impresses people by how quick it is. Like, I'd say for most of our recoveries, unless it's, there've been a handful of primarily bear that went a long distance, or a few liver shot deer that went a long distance. But I would say on 90% of our recoveries, we do it in less than 10 minutes. Like, and then even if it's in a different direction, like, I remember the first bear we ever tracked, this guy brought us way out to this big steep hillside. And I said, yep. So bear was hit right here, and it went north and downhill. And I couldn't for the life of me get Trapper to go north and downhill. He just wanted to go south and up. And I was like, well, I mean, we got to let him do what he wants to do. He's the one in charge here. So we let, turns out that bear had gone north and downhill, but it did a big U underneath and ended up south and uphill of the guy's tree stand. And it just died running because he had put the arrow right into its shoulder, and it just, you know, it turned a tight corner like that. And he didn't care about the blood. He could smell a dead bear over here. That's where we wanted to go.
And that dead bear, as he turned and went south, was upwind.
Yeah.
So Trapper could smell it. Yeah.
No, that's one thing that I like about him is, like, when we get to a hit site, when we get on a call, I have a list of what I call are his priorities. Like, he'll go up to the hit site and he'll smell the blood. Like, I'll tell him to find this right here. Like, I'll point to whether it's an arrow or just a patch of blood or a patch of hair or whatever. And the first thing he does is he sniffs that, and then he sniffs the air, and he'll zigzag all over the place, and he'll just zigzag with his nose up, just sniffing all around him. And if he doesn't find what he wants, then he'll come back to what I told him to smell in the first place. And then he'll start with his nose on the ground, start following it. But he'll keep checking with his nose up in the air. And then as soon as he gets to a point where he gets a little bit of a scent on the air, he doesn't give a shit how much blood's on the ground. He's just going on. He's going to follow his
nose. Switches back to full air scent then. I'm just going into my third year tracking, and, you know, third legitimate year. And I have a bloodhound who's, she does air scent. She will air scent. But, you know, they're nose to ground dogs. You know, that's just how they are, true trackers. So, just to hear, it just seems odd to me, sort of. I don't think odd's the right word. It's intriguing to me because it's so different than what I'm accustomed to with my bloodhound. Yep. That his first go-to is air scenting. That's just cool as crap to me that you said that you give him the scent article, whether it's the arrow or whatever, The first thing he does, okay, can I smell this in the air?
Exactly. It's the first thing he checks every time. And a lot of times he can. Like a lot of times it hasn't gone that far or it's circled around or the wind just happens to be in our feet. He checks it. And, I mean, that's very similar to, like, how he bear hunts, too. You know, because, like, when you think about bear hunting with a hound, the traditional way is to drive around with your hounds until they strike a scent, and then you let them down on it, and then they go off on that. With him, we don't do any, like, we don't travel in the truck or anything like that. We just, I have big areas that I know that will contain bear and that I want to hunt in. And then I wait for a day when the wind is predominantly out of the north or predominantly out of the south. And we start on the downwind side of that big zone, wherever it is. And then we just walk perpendicular to the wind. So it's always hitting us in the side.
Until he cuts one.
And then he'll just put his nose up in the air. And then all of a sudden he'll make a 90-degree turn straight into the air or straight into the wind. And he'll just follow his nose. A nice little trot, nothing fast. He'll stay 30, 40 yards ahead of me. If he loses sight of me or I lose sight of him, because I'm obviously a lot slower, I'll come up over a little hill and he'll just be sitting there waiting for me. And once he sees me, he's like, and then he continues. And he'll keep doing that until he sees the bear. And when he sees it, he'll stop, he'll either sit or he'll lay down, and he just looks back up at me and winks. And then generally, depending upon, you know, where we are, and whether I'll sit down next to him and I'll hook him, and I'll just hook him to me or hook him to a tree. And then we start looking at the bear, and that's when I start doing my judging. And whether or not I want to shoot it or not, you know, we'll either, if I choose not to, we'll just sit there and watch the bear for a little bit, because it's always upwind of us and has no idea we're there. So I generally get a chance to watch quite a few bears with him. And then if I decide to shoot it, then take my shot, you know, and either it drops or it runs away. If it runs away, then we just track like normal on lead, just bring him up to it and go.
So generally speaking, how far away are you from the bear when Trapper says, oh, there he is, and let me just plop here and wait for pop? I mean, are you 100 yards? Are you 50 yards?
He's never much more than 30 or 40 yards ahead of me. If he's more than that, he'll stop and wait.
But what about when he indicates a bear? How close to the bear are you guys usually?
It could, so it all depends on the day. I mean, I've had him like take that 90-degree hard turn and then follow him for 2 miles, and then there's the bear 2 miles away. I've had it be a couple hundred yards. I've had it be a mile before. I've had it. It's all variance. Has a lot to do with wind speed more than anything else. Just how fast the wind's hitting us on that day, because obviously it's going to carry scent further and further and further. And it's just about where the bear, or the closest bear, happens to be on that particular day to where we're walking. He'll just bring me to the closest one. And it's
so this is fascinating to me. So, and that's just a testament to his nose, that bear a mile away, and he cuts it scent and tracks it down. So when he spots the bear and stops, and you tie him off, generally speaking, how close does he get to the bear before he stops?
Depends on the terrain. Anywhere from 100 to 200 yards. Okay. If it's really open, you know, like if we're coming out to a big old clearing or coming out into – we got a couple spots around here where there's like really big old growth yellow birch and beech. So like there's less brush in the ground. Then we can generally see further, you know, and if it's up on it, like say we're tracking up a hill versus down, he can actually see further. You know, he'll stop when he sees the bear. When he can physically lay his eyes on it, he'll stop.
That's when he stops, huh?
Exactly. I mean, if I told him to keep going, he would. A couple times it has been 200 yards, and at 200 yards through the brush, like up on a hill, really hard to judge a bear. So then we'll sneak closer until I can actually see it good in a scope or a pair of binoculars. And we'll just, and then, you know, and generally I like, if I'm going to take a shot at something, I like it to be 100 yards or less. So it's all about sneaking close, and he'll just, you know, once we have it in sight, he just stays right there by my heel. Silent as can be. At most, he'll do like a little, why aren't you shooting yet? That would be about it.
Yeah. What do you, what's your bear rifle?
35 Whalen. Single shot. Whalen.
Okay. Yep. Nice.
No, I don't like the track for myself too much. I'd rather just be over.
I don't blame you. I don't blame you a bit. Yeah, this is just, this is what I love about this. You know, we think of, I think, generally speaking, when we talk about tracking in the tracking community, we're talking about a dog putting his nose on the ground and following that interdigital scent and all of that whole scent cocktail we talk about. Now, sure, trapper's going to do some of that, but just the different styles, and one isn't necessarily any better than the other, you know, per se. It's just different styles, and it's just, that's what I love about it, man. It's just, you know,
absolutely
the different styles and in the way the dogs work, the different approaches to training, which we touched on a little bit in the forum, and we don't really have time to dive into that here. And I know from the forum, you say you don't do a lot of off-season training.
Don't do any.
Okay. So hell,
he doesn't like it. He gets bored with it. He did it for the first year. And then between our first and second season, I brought him back to a couple of those classes, and he just, when he smells a fake line, he turns his nose up at it. And he's like, let's go do something else. Let's go chase. Sure, he knows the difference.
Wow. Yeah. That's and I hear about that too. You know, we hear about that a lot with some dogs don't like to run practice lines, especially the seasoned dogs, because they know they're fake, you know.
Yep.
They know
they're not, absolutely. You
know? But that,
I mean, for as much as they can pull out of a track, I would imagine that fake lines are missing so much to them.
You know, compared to a
real one where there is an actual animal standing right there, and then all of a sudden there's just blood or just a little hoof, like it's got to be night and day for them, I would think.
Oh, I think the same thing, Jeremiah. Yeah, I mean, totally different. So one of the things we talked about, we touched on during the Trackers Forum, was just your population of coyotes and koi dogs. And when you said koi dogs during the Trackers Forum, I didn't know what you meant. I didn't know what that was. And you explained it to me before we started recording, but I always wondered. So explain to the listeners who, like me, may not know, what is a koi dog?
Well, koi dogs, I mean, it's pretty simple. It's just, we have populations of coyotes, and then you have other factors that get into their genetics, and they can breed with timber wolves, other different, or domestic dogs. And koi dogs are just when at some point in their genetic history, they've had more than just coyote bred into them. They've gotten tangled up with some domestic line of dog, whether it's German Shepherd or who knows what. We don't really know.
Yeah.
But generally, by breeding in domestic dog breeds, it makes them a little bit bigger. It makes them a little bit more, just more sizable than normal coyotes. And you can tell by looking at them, because they have different shapes to them. They have a different, and whether it's, you know, they got some timber wolf in them, they got some husky in them, who knows? But they, you know, they have, it's not just a coyote genetic line. So we have quite a few dogs around here that will go well above 50, 60 pounds, which pretty much makes them not a coyote.
So do they, so pardon my ignorance and don't laugh at me on camera here, but are they a koi dog? Are they running with coyote packs, or are they kind of like their own little community feral freaking weirdos, or what?
I think it completely changes. I mean, we have a large number of just wild dogs around here, and we'll have packs. Like, I get them on trail camera all the time. I've had one trail camera picture with 14 dogs in it. I've had other ones where there's just two or three dogs, and they're the same two or three dogs. Like, I think the pack varieties change, and I think the composition of those also. I mean, I don't think it's not like there's specifically one pack of just domestic bred in dogs running around together. No, it's pretty well mixed up. Like, they're part of the coyote population for sure. It's just over time, some parts of different populations have gotten, whether it's because someone's dogs unneutered and running around through the woods unchecked, mm-hmm. and they happen to coincide with a breeding cycle, or it's coyotes coming in when, you know, like a female coyote coming in when you happen to have a male who's, you know, not neutered, and they just happen to, they want to be bred. Like, I think,
yeah, dogs, right.
I mean, there's certainly instances where they kill each other and whatnot, but it's bound to happen at some point, and certainly seems to have done so.
So the population in Vermont of coyote and coy dog is so great that you guys really can't afford.
I really suggest getting on your deer, even gut shot ones. I've had more than I can count on two hands of deer where you wait just overnight and like get on it first thing in the morning, and all you're finding is a set of horns and a skeleton. It'll just be rolled, like the hide will be rolled right up. They'd clean everything. And there's, unless you're just going in for the horns, which there's a fair bit of that here in Vermont, but I'd say the majority of the people I track for are hunting for meat. So if you're really hunting for meat and that's what you're looking for, and it's not just about horns, you really need to get on it. Because what I tell everybody is, think about how good a tracking dog is. Coyotes are out there and they're better because they're hungry. Like they're constantly out there. They're not in here sitting on the couch waiting for a tracking call. They're out there wandering around the woods. And as soon as, I mean, if a dog can pick it up as easy as they can, I mean, you think about a deer laying out a blood trail or a gut trail throughout the woods, the longer that trail is, the more likelihood a coyote's going to cross it at some point. And then they're, as soon as they smell that, it's game over. Like we like to think, you know, when we get on one and it's a gut shot deer and we're going to bump it, we'll never see it. That's not a coyote. They'll bump it, and they'll keep bumping it until they do see it.
Yeah. They're going to get that deer for sure. 100%. And, you know, their drive is different, although, you know, tracking dogs will have different levels of drive and different purposes for why they want to track, I suppose. But coyotes do it for survival. They have to.
Oh, absolutely.
They would love it if they came cross
paths with a deer that has an arrow in it or has a blown off. That's perfect for them. They like that even more.
They're not going to be easily dissuaded from a track. So
no, I mean, I've definitely been on them before. Where like 2 years ago, we had one just down the road. I tried to tell you guys about this a little bit, where a guy got shot a doe during during archery. And he was literally 5 minutes down the road from me. I was like, all right, well, let's give it a little bit just so that she calms down. We were standing over that doe 3 hours after he let the arrow fly, and we kicked the coyotes off of her. She was still alive. But they had chewed off one quarter and ripped the hide off of her. Like, they were going for right behind her shoulder, trying to get at her heart and her lungs. And when we walked up to her, you could see her lungs inflating and deflating inside of her. And she was just... I mean, it's about the most horrible way to go. So we dispatched her, gutted her out, and started dragging her. And as we drug her, they followed us all the way back. I mean, the only reason I didn't shoot at him is because, like, I didn't know what was – I knew we were close to some houses and whatnot, and it's just not worth shooting at night like that.
Okay, so it was after dark. And you close enough you could actually see the damn things?
With my headlight, you could see all the eyes. You could tell there were at least 7-8 dogs, and they were. And as we walked away from them, they maintained that minimum distance.
That's creepy as crap, man. I would
pull way back.
Well, you just said something that we haven't touched on yet. That you know, because during the trackers forum, we all kind of all of the other trackers were almost appalled. Oh my God, you track a gut shot at 1 hour? You know, hell, I was one of them that was kind of taken back by that. But you just said something that we're touching on, and for the listeners that didn't hear that story in the trackers forum is in Vermont, you have tracker dispatch. So if you come across the live deer, you're able to dispatch it.
Generally speaking, if I can get within, 30, 40 feet of it, I can shoot it. Yeah. So
we don't have tracker dispatch in Michigan. And we have a few minutes left here, but what is there a a guiding principle or a rule or a law or something that says the deer must be within X amount of distance before for you to legally, or can you say, oh, there goes a deer 200 yards across the field. Let me take my rifle and shoot it.
So there's limits
for tracker dispatch now for tracker dispatch.
So for tracker dispatch, it's only at night unless we deem it unsafe during the day. During the day, during season, if it's in season, the hunter has to dispatch unless we as the tracker deem it unsafe, which that's happened to me once or twice. Cause like I showed up to track for a guy and they didn't bring their weapon because it was, they thought it would be dead. And then we come across a live animal and all they have is a knife. That's not safe for them to go up there and stick it.
Yeah, right.
Depending on how, you know, how lively it is. So in that instance, during the day, I can shoot it. But I am, as a tracker and with the ability to dispatch at primarily at night, I'm limited to a handgun. I can't have a rifle or shotgun or anything like that. Okay. Has to be at least 35 caliber, and I've got to have at least a 4-inch barrel. So I use a Ruger Super Blackhawk 44 mag. And that, just in the fact you're limited to a handgun, I think limits you to, you know, reasonable shots. I mean, it's not like I'm going to, like, if there's a deer bounding across a field at 120 yards, I'm not plugging away at it with
it. Of course. Yeah. It's just not going to happen.
So everything I've ever dispatched, I mean, it's, I'd say the furthest away was about 40 feet. And then other than that, I'm usually 5 to 6 feet away from them.
Yeah, just enough to, okay. I happen to have a Ruger Super Blackhawk 44 Magnum, well, 8-inch barrel.
Yeah.
I don't use it anymore. I used to carry it all the time hunting, but I don't anymore.
Yeah.
It's heavy. well, that's cool, man. Well, doggone, whole bunch of stuff we're talking about. What the heck else was I? You said something else that I wanted to ask about. I don't remember what it was. I don't remember what it was. Well, Jeremiah, what haven't we talked about that you think's worth mentioning in the next, you know, 4 to 6 minutes here?
Well, I guess the other thing I'd say, what I like about tracking with Trapper more than anything else is he's definitely a dog who has, he has his ways about him. And I've gotten to a point, like, now that we're, you know, we've done our fourth season, I've gotten to read him a lot. And I think one of the things that works with him, and especially on tracks where we're not necessarily finding things, when I start a track, I always tell a tracker or a hunter what I'm looking for out of him. Like, as far as if we're going to recover something, like, because I always say, you know, you follow behind me, you look at the trail, because I'm not really paying attention much to the blood. I'm not paying attention. Right. Trapper goes pretty fast. He's a runner for sure. And I've got about all I can to keep up with him. So I'm watching him more than anything else. So there's certain things that he does. Like if we're on a track and he's pulling and he's looking back at me at all, that's always a bad sign. Like, and I tell it, it's like, if you see the dog, like, kind of like looking over his shoulder and looking at me, and he's not just head going up straight in the direction he wants to go, like, that's not a good thing. It's like, that's one thing where he's like telling me that this isn't going to happen well, or it's, you know, we're not on something that he thinks we're even close to.
Right.
And then one of the other, so kind of a cool fact about elk hounds too, like I said, their tails are, they have a long tail, but it curls right up onto their back. But what's cool about that is it's a gauge. As they get close to what it is they're tracking, their tail uncurls.
And oh, no kidding.
It's just like when his tail's up on his back, like whether it's tracking or bear hunting, like I know we're nowhere's even close. Like rifles on my shoulder, I'm not ready. Like we're getting to it. But as we get closer, once we start breaking that, like we're within 200 yards mark, his tail just opens up. And when it's straight down between his legs, that means he's excited and it's right there.
That is an outstanding tell.
It's very handy. It really is.
Oh man, that's just a flag. He just hoisted a flag saying, hey, pop, you know, we're close. Get ready.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's why I tell people a lot, like he big game hunts the way that a pointing dog bird hunts.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like it's, he's got almost the same tells, and he has a few little audible ones. Like mostly he's got a little puff when we're close to something that's alive. But I mean, cause like the tail, it doesn't matter. Like they can be a dead deer or a live deer. I don't know. I just know we're within proximity.
Right. Yeah.
It's more about that getting stronger and being close enough to being like what he's found.
Yeah.
But like he has other, lots of other little tells that when I explain them to the hunters before we go, and then they're behind me, and then all of a sudden he starts doing that stuff, then they're seeing the whole picture as, you know, kind of like, you know, it's easier in that way for me to justify like, oh, we're not finding something and this is why. It's because he, you know, we're not having the scent he's looking for, or we're not, you know, it's just not working out for the.
Well, they're engaged with the track now. Exactly. They know what's going on. They can get a feel for it. You know, it's not just a nose on the ground sniffing things. They know now. Yeah. Well, that's cool. Well, look, man, we're about up against it, buddy. This has been a fun conversation, and I appreciate it. And yeah, we'll certainly stay in touch and come back. You know, you know we can talk about other things at other times. And who knows? Carrie may bully us into doing a Trackers Forum Part 4. Who knows? But look, man, it's been a ton of fun. I appreciate you coming on. I appreciate your participation in the Trackers Forums. And
yeah, happy to do that.
Yeah, we'll continue to stay in touch, guys. So, hey, listeners, remember, Tales on Trails Deer Tracking on Facebook and YouTube. Please go to Gracie Tracking Service Facebook page and follow Jeremiah. And, you know, more the good, less the bad, guys. We'll talk to you soon. Thank you.